Hello and welcome back to this European SchoolNet course on developing digital skills in the classroom. This is module 5 of the course, which is on social media. And in this part of module 5, we're going to be looking at social media as a learning network. So, before we start to look at social media as a learning network, I want to refer to some research from my friend Dr. Alex Kouros, who's a Canadian educator. And when he was developing his PhD, he developed two models. A model around the traditional teacher network, which, as you can see, was mainly one way. It was information being delivered to the teacher. And the only two-way dialogue might be with colleagues in the staff room or speaking to members of the family in the local community. That was the first model. But then what he then described as a networked teacher or a modern teacher. And of course, the beauty of the network teacher is that they're able to use all of the rich and wonderful resources that are available via the internet. And if you go around the circle there and you look at that carefully, you'll see that many of these services that Dr. Kouros is talking about there are social networking services, whether it's a wiki, a blog, a social bookmark, or some form of digital photo or video sharing. It's now absolutely possible for a network teacher to be connected to the latest research, to be connected with colleagues that have got a similar interest, and to be connected, most importantly, to other classrooms around the world. And if I move this then into the context of my own knowledge and experiences, I think when I think about my own personal learning network, I can divide this up into three parts. And this is face-to-face, digital closed communities, and open digital communities. Now, face-to-face, very similar to Dr. Kouros's model, is very, very important to me. Face-to-face are the people that I come into contact with in my school and in my education system every day, whether that's a teacher, whether that's a member of the senior management team, whether that's a member of the education centre, whether that's a parent, a member of the local community, or whether that's a child. Face-to-face contact for advice and being critical friends is incredibly important. But I'm also a member of a number of digital closed communities. Now, what I mean by a digital closed community is it's normally a digital place which is free to join, but when I sign up, I'm going to find out about a certain thing. For example, the course that you're taking part in at the moment would be a good example of a digital closed community. It's free to join, but once you've joined, you're part of a closed community where you can, for example, use some of the tools that are available to you, the discussion forum, where you can earn your digital badges. And the reason that we're all part of that community is because we're all interested in developing digital skills in the classroom. I'm also part of the Google Educators Group Scotland and the Microsoft Educators Network, but more about those services in a minute. The final part then of my professional learning network is what I would describe as digital open communities. These are different communities that I'm involved in and a part of, where I can pretty much discuss anything that I want to do on the web. Sometimes there's a bit of a blurring between what I do in my personal life and what I do in my professional life, because I use these services for a little bit of both. These are traditionally services like Facebook, Google+, Twitter, Slideshare, or other services that are pulled together using RSS, such as blogs and wikis. However, being part of all three of these things allows me to improve my knowledge, it allows me to improve my skills, and it allows me to improve as being a reflective practitioner. So let's have a quick look at some of these online communities and micro networks, some of which you will have heard of and some of which might be new to you. I'd like to recommend the Microsoft Educators Network, even if you're not interested in Microsoft technologies. The reason I'd like to recommend it is because they've got some really, really good resources in there for school improvement. There's also discussion forums, and there's an opportunity for people to sign up to become part of the Microsoft Innovative Schools Network. There are also hot topic discussions which occur most months around contemporary issues such as mobile phones in schools, or how we can get a better use out of technology, which is often expensive if we buy it. It's a really, really good, long-established network, and I've been part of it now for over 10 years, and I've had a lot of value out of it. More recent networks are the Google Educators Group. I'm a member of the Google Educators Group Scotland, but there are now Google Educators Groups in most European countries. If there's not a Google Educators Group for your country, then you can set one up, All you have to do is be in contact with Google. It's worth going out and exploring this because the Google suite of tools, as we already know from Module 2, are free and also extremely powerful. Other large technology companies also run teacher professional networks. Promethean is a company that was once famous for interactive whiteboards. Now it's got a whole suite of products, from interactive whiteboards, interactive voting systems, to interactive tables, to a range of mobile apps. And for one time, they were the biggest online teacher professional development community. Again, worth looking at because it's a great place to be able to share resources with people from around the world. The biggest teacher community at the moment currently on the internet is the Times Educational Supplement. Again, this was originally about advertising jobs, but it's now become a place where people can upload their own content and also view other people's content as well. There are lots of rich discussions in some of the discussion forums, and again, if you're not a member, it might be worth checking out. There are lots of other communities as well. A similar project from the European SchoolNet is around eTwinning.net. eTwinning is an incredibly powerful thing to do within your school or within your classroom, because not only does it allow children to connect with other children across Europe, developing citizenship skills, but it also allows teachers to connect and to share that professional dialogue. Increasingly, we're also starting to see Facebook be used as a digital platform for teachers to collaborate and to share ideas and to swap resources. Another project that I'm involved in as part of the European Schools Net is the Games in Schools initiative. If you are interested in some of the games design content that we showed you at the end of Module 3, I would suggest that you sign up to the Games in School Facebook group, and then we'll notify you if we're going to run another Games in Schools e-learning MOOC, which hopefully we'll do in the distant future. Twitter is a great example of a micro network. And the interesting thing about Twitter is you can start to splice things together using tags or hashtags. I've been really pleased with the way that some of the participants on this course have been using the hashtag eSkills course. Now, let's take a hashtag as an example. Let's take the hashtag BetChat. Now, Bet is the world's largest education technology trade show, currently hosted in London in January every year. And if I put the hashtag BetChat into Twitter, then what do I start to see? Is I start to see all of the tweets that are associated with that hashtag. If I want to produce it as a digital newsletter, I can't recommend TwazUp enough. TwazUp is a way that you can put the hashtag into the website and it pulls together all of the video, all of the tweets, and all of the links. And then it categorizes them in terms of the ones that are the most popular. It's a great way to be able to get a quick summary of a conference. It's also a great way to be able to get a quick summary of what people have been talking about on this e-learning course. If you're interested in Twitter, then maybe you want to have a little look at the wiki twitterforteachers.pwworks.com. And the thing about Twitter for Teachers is that this suggests different people that you might want to follow via your subject area. There's literally hundreds of people on there these days, but if you're a geography teacher, for example, you can follow geography teachers. If you're a school leader or a head teacher, you can follow school leaders or head teachers. It's a good way to find new people to follow. And the last sort of social network site that I want to mention is now owned by LinkedIn, and that's Slideshare. Now, we all know that teachers like using presentations in the classroom, and Slideshare is the YouTube of PowerPoint or Keynote presentations. It's a great way to be able to publish your own presentations for students to view, but it's also a great way as well for you be able to go on and to find other presentation ideas. If you've not played with or explored Slideshare for a while, I suggest you go back and have a little look. Finally, when I'm talking about using social media for professional learning, I can't really not mention this course. We've been using social media to share ideas via Twitter, to develop an online discussion during the Facebook page, as well as the forum questions and answers actually within the closed community on the European SchoolNet Academy website. And of course, even this video that you're watching is available by YouTube, and you're welcome to share it and to embed it in your own website because it's available via a Creative Commons website. If you're interested in some of the research from this, I suggest that you check out Tweeting for Teachers, How Can Social Media Support Teacher Professional Development? And that was published by Notosh and the Pearson Centre for Policy and Learning back in 2011. But there's still lots of really good content in there, which is well worth checking out. So there we go. That's the end of that video. Some ideas there about how you might use social media to develop your own personal learning networks. And I hope that we can continue in this discussion a long time after this e-learning course is finished. See you in the next video.